Myself, Dr. Vasudha Nikam, Professor and Head of the Department of Anatomy. So today we will deliver a lecture regarding the venous drainage of the lower limb, regarding very important vein, clinically important, surgically important, that is the great saphenous vein. So we will deal today with the great saphenous vein.
So what do you know about this great saphenous vein? As already you have read.
So as whatever you have read about the great saphenous vein in the books, that is the longest cutaneous vein of our body. This is the peculiarity for the GSV, and the term saphenous is derived from a Greek terminology. Saphenous means easily seen. What is the peculiarity of this vein in the lower limb? It represents the preaxial vein of our limb. Plus, when we compare this vein with the histological aspect or the structure of the veins in our body, there are the three layers, tunica intima, tunica media and tunica adventitia. But normally in the superficial veins, tunica media is very thin as compared to the other deeper veins of our body. But here, tunica media, when compared to other cutaneous vein, it is modified into a larger size because it has to resist the force of venous return, which is coming against gravity, which is carried to the inferior vena cava. Plus, tunica media has also modified smooth cells, which are clinically important for the contraction carrying the blood to the or against gravity. Now we are going to see the course of the great saphenous vein over here. This is the dorsum of our foot, and it begins on the dorsum of the foot as the continuation of medial dorsal venous arch. So this regarding the course, what you see in the dorsum of the foot, that is now the dorsal venous arch. Now this dorsal venous arch, it is supplemented by two more veins, one on the medial side and second on the lateral side. And this medial vein is considered as a medial marginal vein, which comes and joins this medial end of the dorsal venous arch, and there comes the formation of the great saphenous vein. Now this vein comes upwards towards the medial malleolus of tibia for about 2.5 centimeters and then now ascends obliquely upwards towards the medial surface of the lower third of the tibia about a finger's breadth behind the medial border of the tibia and comes to lie on the posterior medial side of our knee joint, where it is situated about one hand's breadth posterior to patella. Again now it is going to ascend along the medial side of our thigh to reach the saphenous opening, which is present in our fascia lata. Now at the level of the saphenous opening now, we have a cribriform fascia, and this cribriform fascia is now pierced by the GSV and it will drain into now the deeper vein called as the femoral vein. This is the inguinal ligament, which represents the border of our groin region. Now as this vein is clinically very important, we should know this, which are the accompanying structures along with the course of this vein. So if you see this, structures in the thigh, in the leg, as well as in the foot. You can see now in the thigh, we get the nerve called as the medial femoral cutaneous nerve of thigh. So branches are going to supply the skin along the anteromedial side of our thigh. Near the knee, we are having the artery very parallel running to the GSV, and that is called as saphenous artery, which is a branch of descending genicular artery. The third foremost very important is a nerve, a very cutaneous and the longest nerve of our body, and that is called as saphenous nerve, which is a branch of femoral nerve. Then if you go for the tributaries, very important, all the tributaries, they carry the blood against gravity towards the GSV. So regarding these tributaries, GSV has multiple number of tributaries over here. And if you consider the leg here, we get a posterior arch vein, which will collect the blood from the posterior medial side of our calf. Apart from that, on the anterior aspect, we are also having the anterior leg veins. It drains the blood usually from the, it drains the blood along with the anteromedial as well as the anterolateral part of the leg. Plus, we are having few calf veins, which drain the posterior part of our calf. As we run towards the thigh region, we are having two more veins over here. One is called as the anterolateral, second is called as posteromedial. Anterolateral, which arises from the venous plexus at the apex of the femoral triangle and drains the lateral side of the thigh. Posteromedial vein is sometimes also referred as accessory saphenous vein, and it drains the posteromedial part of our thigh. as we go towards the cribriform fascia and this saphenous opening, we are having few more veins over here. One is called as superficial epigastric vein, superficial circumflex iliac vein, superficial external pudendal vein. Now in this superficial epigastric vein drains the lower part of the anterior abdominal wall. Superficial circumflex iliac vein drains the lateral part of our hip region, and superficial external pudendal, we use the word external because it lies superficial to the spermatic cord, it drains the genitalia. Deep to spermatic cord also we are having one more vein, and that is called as deep external pudendal vein, which will collect the blood from the perineal region. Go for the perforators. What do you mean by the word perforators? Perforators are those communicating veins which will join the superficial veins to the deeper veins. Now we classify these perforators as direct and indirect, and regarding the blood flow, the unidirectional blood flow is always maintained by the perforators. So if you see the structure in the thigh over here, we are having the skin, we are having the superficial fascia which will contain these superficial veins. This superficial fascia is always having a boundary of deep fascia. Then behind this deep fascia, we will be having a deep vein over here. Now, what do you mean by direct perforator? You can see the picture over here. The superficial veins are directly connected to the deeper veins, and this structure is considered as a direct perforator. Walls are inside the perforator, which will always maintain the unidirectional blood flow, and the retrograde flow from the deeper veins to the superficial veins is not allowed. So we have seen the direct perforator. Now we will go to the indirect perforator. If you see the structure of the indirect perforator, see the position of the superficial veins. It is same like direct perforators, where you go these veins into the superficial fascia. This is the deep fascia of the thigh. Now we can see these are the direct perforators, and you can see they're embedding in a muscle of the thigh. So in the muscle of the thigh, you will get a multiple network considered as a sinusoid. Now this muscle has a capacity to contract. After contracting, the blood from superficial veins is directly carried to the deeper veins, and such construction of the veins is considered as the indirect perforators. So this is now the indirect perforator what we have seen. Now we will go to the perforators of GSV, which are usually helping or assisting us to carry the blood against gravity. So what do you mean by now perforators? These are the connecting small veins which join our GSV with the deeper veins in the lower limb, and they are needed or necessary for the proper venous drainage of venous blood against gravity. Now we have seen the dorsal venous arch over here. This is the GSV. This is a small saphenous vein. Now see the positions of the perforators. Normally these are direct perforators as well as few are indirect. Now in that first position, if you'll go for the veins over here, these are some deeper veins which drain the blood from the GSV and perforators. The posterior tibial vein, collectively the blood will go to the popliteal vein. Collectively it will be carried to the femoral vein. Now if you see the position of the perforators, you can see here, this is called as mid-hunter perforator, which is situated at the level of the adductor canal, hence also referred as the adductor canal perforator. This is going to connect the great saphenous vein with the femoral vein near the adductor canal. Second, situated at the level of the knee joint, it is called as knee perforator, which will connect the great saphenous vein with the posterior tibial vein, usually lies below the knee region. Three medial perforators, which are considered as the ankle perforators, which are going to connect the great saphenous vein with the posterior tibial vein and present at the lower third of the tibia. So we have seen these perforators. Now we will go inside the vein over here, which where it is embedded by a large number of the walls over here. As the great saphenous vein has to drain the venous blood against gravity, so we need to prevent the regurgitation. So it is provided by number of walls, and about 10 to 20 walls are present, out of which one wall is present before it pierces the cribriform fascia. And clinically, it's very important over here. One more vein which is present at the junction of the femoral vein, which is called as the saphenofemoral wall. Now, this saphenofemoral wall has a functional importance. And regarding this femoral vein, which will drain into the external iliac vein, this vein is also having a wall, but this is usually present only in the 80% of the people. Now this external iliac vein, which is having a wall, always protects the saphenofemoral junction against high pressure. The remaining 20% people where the wall inside the external iliac vein is absent usually becomes the victim of varicose veins. Considering the applied anatomy of the great saphenous vein over here, go for the venous graft. Already we know this terminology, bypass surgery. What do you mean by word bypass? This is seen in classically in the blockage of the coronary arteries, where the blood supply to the heart weakens out. So we are going to bypass the blood from the coronary arteries. We are going to directly supply this blood to the myocardium, which is affected. So if you see this diagram, you can see here the coronary artery, which is blocked over here, and this is considered as a decreased blood flow to the myocardium, which is affecting over here, leading to infarction. Now in the second diagram, what we are going to see here, we have grafts over here. In one part we have shown a venous graft, and in the second part we have shown the arterial graft. The venous graft previously was used, and only it was used by grafting the great small segment of a great saphenous vein over here. Nowadays we preferably go for arterial graft, which is taken directly from the internal thoracic artery, and it is ligated to the affected myocardium, which will always normalize the blood flow to the affected myocardium. Second, you should know what is venesection. The name itself tells us, section of vein is considered as venesection, and it is an art of drawing or removing the blood from the circulatory system through a small or a puncture for the purpose of analysis, blood donations, or any treatment considering blood disorders. So here GSV, as it is a more superficial to our body and very commonly used for the venesection near the ankle region, it is done in severely dehydrated patients where other superficial veins are collapsed, and as the superficial position is there for GSV, it can be easily accessed and we can remove it and we can incise it. So regarding this venesection, care should be taken regarding one more nerve over here, and that is called as saphenous nerve, and this is a cutaneous nerve which supplies the medial border of our foot up to great toe. Care has to be taken not to damage this nerve as so as to maintain the cutaneous nerve supply of our foot. Very important condition, one more considered as varicose veins over here, and the lower limb veins are very dominantly affected by this disease. In that, great saphenous vein is commonest site for the varicosities, and it is due to improper venous drainage of lower limbs. It produces discomfort in the lower limbs. The GSV, except close to their termination, usually it is situated in the subcutaneous fat, and there is no any advantage, or it is deprived of the advantage of the muscle pump, and this leads to the stagnation of the varicosities very commonly as the walls becomes incompetent because of the retrograde blood flow. GSV is the commonest site for the varicosities, and you can see the affected site of this GSV as well as the structure which is being tortuosity where it has been increased. Go for varicose veins. Now what do you mean by varicose veins? It is defined as a vein to be varicose when it is the diameter is greater than normal, it becomes elongated as well as it becomes very tortuous. Now what are the sites of the varicosities in our body? Already as we have discussed, superficial veins of the lower limb, esophageal veins at the lower end, some rectal veins, as well as in cases of males, the testicular plexus called as pampiniform plexus. What are the causes for such varicosities in our body? First is hereditary weakness of vein walls. Second, incompetency of the walls which are present inside the vein. Chronic increase in intra-abdominal pressures due to multiple pregnancy or increasing abdominal tumors. Thrombophlebitis of the deep veins. In 80% people, the valve in the external iliac vein always protects the saphenofemoral junction against high pressure. Hence, remaining 20% people are prone for the varicose veins of our lower limb. Now, what is the mechanism of the formation of the veins? This depends upon the venous drainage of the lower limb veins. Factors normally which assist us, the venous drainage of the lower limb act against gravity. So in upright posture of the body, the venous return from the lower limb has to be carried against gravity, and it is largely dependent on the effective of the muscular contraction on vena cavitans accompanying the deep arteries of our limb. The arterial pulsations also help in the process. The deep fascia is very strong, and as a result, muscular contraction as well as arterial pulsations have a squeezing effect over the deep veins which aid the venous return. The muscular mechanism is known as calf pump muscle, and the solely responsible muscle is the soleus, present in the posterior compartment of our leg, which is also called as the peripheral heart or the calf muscle pump. When this muscle is going to contract, blood contained in the large sinuses, it is pumped into the deeper veins, and when the muscle relaxes, blood flows into the sinuses from the superficial veins. Always unidirectional blood flow is maintained by the walls which are present inside the perforating veins. The venous return is further facilitated by the arrangement of these valves, and the perforating valves are valved at each end, which will permit the flow from superficial to deep veins and not from the opposite direction. in recumbent position, the force produced by the contraction of the heart as well as the suction action of the diaphragm during inspiration are sufficient to maintain the venous return. Now, when the soleus is going to contract, blood in the large sinuses within it is pumped into the deeper veins. When the muscle relaxes, blood flows into the sinuses from the superficial veins. Suppose now in the perforating veins, if these valves becomes incompetent, the defective veins, now they are considered as high pressure leaks. Due to this, there is a dilatation of the superficial veins and gradual degeneration of their walls producing varicose veins takes place. Now, what are the complications of this varicosities of the lower limb? One is the varicose ulcer. In this, the skin over the varicose veins become very weak. Even a minor injury may lead to the bleeding. Due to this, healing does not occur, leading to chronic varicose ulcer. Second is thrombophlebitis. In case of this, thrombophlebitis is very common in the varicose veins, and the thrombus from the superficial veins is carried to the deeper veins, which breaks the walls and further carried to the heart as well as the pulmonary artery. If the pulmonary thrombus is smaller, there are no symptoms, but if it is larger in size, it may lead to the sudden death, which is called as pulmonary embolism. What are the tests to diagnose the varicose veins over here? Classically, we prefer to Trendelenburg box test. And this is done to find out the leak in the patients with varicose veins only. Here, only superficial and perforating veins can be tested and not the deeper veins. What is the mechanism to test these varicose veins now? The patient is made to lie down and the veins are emptied by raising the limb above the level of the heart to empty the varicose veins. A rubber tubing is applied firmly around the upper thigh to occlude the saphenous vein but not the femoral vein. The patient is now allowed to stand and do gentle exercise. Now go for the observations. If the varicosities remain empty for 30 seconds, the perforating vein below the tubing are competent. If the filling takes place within this time, the perforators are incompetent. If the collapsed vein fills at once on removal of the tubing, the saphenofemoral valve is incompetent. Now, how the diagnosis and the assessment of the varicose vein can be done? Some of the helpful radiological methods, one is a Doppler ultrasound and second is a duplex ultrasound. Recently, we go for these trends. Now, what is the mode of treatment? There are three modes of treatment: conservative, surgical, as well as non-surgical. Now, what do you mean by conservative methods? The symptoms can be controlled by elevating the legs, regular exercise, wearing of compression stockings with variable pressure gradients which improve the microcirculation in legs affected by varicose veins. If painful conditions are there, anti-inflammatory medications such as ibuprofen or aspirin can be used as a part of treatment for superficial thrombophlebitis. What are surgical methods of treatment? Surgically, we go for this operation considered as stripping operations or Trendelenburg operation. Nowadays, it is not done. Previously, it was done. Here, the saphenofemoral wall incompetency is recorded. The great saphenous vein is detached from the femoral vein and at its point of the entry. Tributaries in the groin are ligated separately. Now, this is one more method to treat these smaller varicose veins, which is called as ambulatory phlebectomy. This is used to remove the veins near the surface of the legs with a series of skin punctures. It is done under local anesthesia because skin incisions or the needle punctures used to extract veins within a phlebectomic hook. After treatment, a compression bandage as well as compression stockings are given for 1 to 2 weeks. After that, usually if needed, secondary treatment can be given. Third procedure is called as endovenous thermal ablation, which is also called as laser therapy. It is a newest technique that uses a laser or high frequency radio waves to create intense local heat in the varicose veins or incompetent vein. These waves usually from this, the heat is directed through a catheter to close up the targeted vessels. This treatment closes off the problem veins but leaves them in a place so their minimal bleeding and the bruising may take place. This is one of the non-surgical treatment called as sclerotherapy, where liquid is injected into a vein to destroy it. It is done to treat the spider veins. The sclerosants commonly used are polydeconol or sodium tetradecal sulfate, sclerodox, as well as chromated glycerins. One more is non-surgical. It is radiofrequency occlusion, alternative to surgical stripping. This technique is known as closure procedure and directly hits the inner lining of the diseased vein using a radiofrequency catheter instead of a laser filament. A small catheter is inserted, usually through a small needle stick, into a skin, into the damaged vein. The catheter delivers radio frequency energy to the vein, causing it to heat. As the vein warms, it collapses and seals or shuts down. This procedure is generally done in an outpatient or in the office setting. What are the other sites of varicosities in our body? We should know this. One is the esophageal varices, very commonly seen as a complication in the portal hypertension. This occurs at the lower third of the esophagus, as it is a site of portosystemic anastomosis. Here you can see the dilated veins or varicosities inside the mucosal layer. These varicose veins may be ruptured during the passage of food, causing the hematemesis, and it is considered clinically as a fetal condition. Second, this is considered as the piles. These are internal hemorrhoids where the varicosities of the tributaries of the superior rectal vein, which are covered by mucous membrane, they get dilated. Very commonly, they are observed in chronic constipation as well as pregnancy and liver cirrhosis. The third condition, what we are going to see, it is in males, which is called as varicocele. In this condition, there is an elongation and the dilatation of the veins of the pampiniform plexus. Very commonly, it is seen on the left side in the adolescent males. So this is all about regarding this today's lecture. Thank you.